Hachette Audio presents Angels in the Trenches, Spiritualism, Superstition and the Supernatural During the First World War by Dr. Leo Ruickbie, read by Roger Davis. But man, proud man, dressed in a little brief authority, most ignorant of what he's most assured, his glassy essence, like an angry ape, plays such fantastic tricks before high heaven as make the angels weep. William Shakespeare, Measure for Measure, Scene 2. When the war came, it brought earnestness into all our souls and made us look more closely at our own beliefs and reassess their values. In the presence of an agonized world, hearing every day of the deaths of the flower of our race in the first promise of their unfulfilled youth, seeing around one the wives and mothers who had no clear conception whither their loved ones had gone, I seemed suddenly to see that this subject was really something tremendous, a call of hope and of guidance to the human race at the time of its deepest affliction. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, Metropolitan Magazine, January 1918, page 10. Sonnet. Suggested by some of the proceedings of the Society for Psychical Research. Not with vain tears, when we're beyond the sun, we'll beat on the substantial doors, nor tread those dusty high roads of the aimless dead, plaintive for earth, but rather turn and run down some close-covered byway of the air, some low, sweet alley between wind and wind, stoop under faint gleams, thread the shadows, find some whispering, ghost-forgotten nook, and there spend in pure converse our eternal day. Think each in each, immediately wise, learn all we lacked before. Hear, know, and say what this tumultuous body now denies, and feel who have laid our groping hands away, and see, no longer blinded by our eyes. Rupert Brooke, 1913, in 1914 and other poems. Mars Ascendant. Before 1914 even began, its terrible course had already been seen in the stars. Mars, the Roman god of war, and a twinkling red spark in the night sky, had laid claim to 1914. Each year, beginning about 1827, a book of astrological forecasts appeared called Raphael's Almanac, then being published by Robert Thomas Cross, one of a long line of Raphaels. And in 1913, this latest Raphael duly printed his prognosis for the next year. Under the title of The Crowned Heads of Europe, a surprisingly accurate prediction was made. The Kaiser of Germany is under very adverse directions, and danger both to health and person is indicated. The year opens with Mars in square to the radical Sun, and with Uranus transiting the Sun's place at birth and Mars passing over the ascendant, the indications of war and disaster are strongly marked. The Moon is opposed to Uranus in January, a further indication of trouble. A crisis is apparent in the history of the German Empire. A crisis would, of course, be apparent in the histories of all the European empires. A certain Madame de Thèbes, in reality Anne-Victorine Savigny, a noted French clairvoyant and palmist, also published a yearly almanac. She was said to have already predicted the death of the French general Georges-Ernest Boulanger, nicknamed General Revanche, in 1891, the Boer War, 1899-1902, the death of Queen Victoria, 1901, the Russo-Japanese War, 1904-1905, the death of the French poet Catulle Mendès in 1909, the death of the influential journalist and spiritualist William Thomas Stead, who lost his life aboard the Titanic in 1912, the list goes on. When she read Stead's hand, she saw that water was his enemy. Stead apparently replied by telling her that his familiar spirits would save him from drowning. Such predictions had already brought her international fame. In 1913, she was the world's most renowned seeress, in the words of one US newspaper. Her words for 1914 would only add to it. As early as 1903, she had published the prediction that the future of Belgium is extraordinarily sad. Despite an impression of peace and happiness, Belgium will set all Europe in flames. In 1912, she had forecast that Germany menaces Europe in general, and France in particular. It took little in the way of clairvoyance to see that, but Madame de Tebbe added, "The days of the emperor are numbered, and after him all will be changed in Germany." In her 1913 almanac, she prophesied that in Austria, he who expects to reign will not come to the throne, and a young man who should not come to the throne will reign. On the 28th of June 1914, it became clear what she meant. The heir presumptive to the Austro-Hungarian Empire, Archduke Franz Ferdinand, was assassinated, and his nephew Charles became next in line to the throne, reigning as Charles I from 1916. "We are in the full cycle of Mars," she later wrote. As well as publishing her astrological almanac, Madame de Tebbe made her day-to-day living through reading palms. The American writer and poet Ella Wheeler Wilcox, she was the one who wrote "Laugh and the World Laughs with You," went to see her when in Paris, but such was her popularity that she had to wait 2 weeks for an appointment. When she did finally get to see her, she noted the many autographed photographs of European royalty that had been sent as gifts, not to mention photographs of almost every celebrity in Europe. Somewhat to Wilcox's disappointment, de Tebbe predicted the crashing failure of a play she had collaborated on. Great things were expected of it, but the Madame's prognostication was correct. According to Countess Zelinsky, she had seen numerous signs of death and wounds by sword and fire in the palms of Britons who came to see her before August 1914. What, she had asked herself, may signify these signs among so many Englishmen who have no connection or relationship with each other? Can they refer to deaths in war? It was not just in British hands that she saw sad omens. "I see in the hands of distinguished Italians," she wrote in 1913, "signs of a war of unprecedented violence." Before the entry of America into the war, she had seen similar signs multiplying in the hands of Americans, or so it was said. Wilcox had seen the Kaiser reviewing his troops at Mainz in 1906, the year the Royal Navy launched its first dreadnought. "It was a great sight," she told a friend, "but made one feel that universal peace, so much talked about, is a million miles away." It was getting further away every day. When she wrote the line, "We have outgrown the need of war," in 1909, it was a desperate appeal against what she had seen, rather than a statement of fact. The Pittsburgh Press contacted Madame de Tebbe in 1913 to inquire what the next year would bring for the American people. She was not shy in calling the USA the modern Tower of Babel, which had reached the crest of her rise. "The storm is gathering," she warned. "The thunder growls. There would be an explosion as of dynamite, turning your new world upside down." Luckily, through all the disasters and upheaval, America can rise triumphant. Lastly, she suggested that American women should stop wearing pearls and wear diamonds instead, Because diamonds store up sunshine, mankind's first good fortune. The newspaper printed a photograph of her in her Parisian séance studio. We see an elderly woman in a well-appointed library holding a book in her hand and staring into the distance. Around her, one can see some of her collection of 62 model elephants, apparently the best fetish in the sense of magical charm. Nobel Prize winner Maurice Maeterlinck described her on her balcony in Paris, peering, listening, waiting at the threshold of the future. As European events unfolded, these prophecies would be recalled more than once. But whether American women changed their jewellery fashions, we will never know. The war was predicted, Madame de Terbe later said. If the world was not warned, it is because the world paid no attention. In 1936, looking back on the years before the First World War, the American writer Henry James Forman made the sweeping statement that virtually all astrologers predicted a terrible conflict for Europe, and notably for Germany, between the years 1913 and 1916. Europe deluged in blood, Mrs. Foster Turner's prophecy. Since its beginnings in America in 1848, spiritualism had had the time and opportunity to spread across the civilized world. What had begun as mysterious rapping sounds in a modest house in Hydesville, New York State, was now a world movement. Even Queen Victoria had held a séance after the death of Prince Albert. Death, the only certainty in life, posed the greatest question of all, the question that was at the root and heart of all religion. What happens after we die? After eons of shamans, mystics, and priests, and astrologers and palmists too, telling us what lay beyond, spiritualism now offered the possibility to discover it for oneself. One spiritualist medium, a Mrs. Foster Turner, well known in Australia, was at the Little Theatre on Castlereagh Street in Sydney one Sunday in February 1914. Almost 1,000 people were crammed into the theatre to witness her trance communications. Those at the back jostled and strained their necks for a view of the woman. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle met her some years later and described her as a middle-aged lady of commanding and pleasing appearance, with a dignified manner and a beautifully modulated voice. She was, he thought, the greatest all-round medium with the highest general level of any sensitive in Australia. And now, eyes closed, she was speaking in a voice not her own. The famous British spiritualist, W.T. Stead, now dead, was speaking through her from the beyond. Now, although there is not at present a whisper of a great European war at hand, yet I want to warn you that before this year 1914 has run its course, Europe will be deluged in blood. Great Britain, our beloved nation, will be drawn into the most awful war the world has ever known. Germany will be the great antagonist and will draw other nations in her train. Austria will totter to its ruin. Kings and kingdoms will fall. Millions of precious lives will be slaughtered. But Britain will finally triumph and emerge victorious. During the year also, the Pope of Rome will pass away, and a bomb will be placed in St. Paul's Church, but will be discovered in time and removed before damage is done. Pope St. Pius X died on the 20th of August 1914 as German troops marched into Brussels. Since suffering from a heart attack in 1913, he had been in constant ill health. But the bomb went off in St. George's Church, Hanover Square, London. Suffragettes planted the device, which exploded some minutes after 10 o'clock on the 14th of June 1914. Firemen forced the doors and found the building filled with dense smoke and some pews and stained glass windows damaged. An envelope was found containing the message, a protest against the torture of women. Only some shouting was said to have disrupted a service at St. Paul's Cathedral. The year before, a bomb had been found in St. Paul's and was safely removed. Suffragettes were again to blame. Millions will die. Sophie's prophecy. Summer in Athens. Sunbeams like lances breaking on the white city. In a shaded room, Dr. Antoniou sits in his chair. Across from him, a young woman, 18 years old, lies on a couch. She is in a hypnotic trance. Dr. Antoniou has written, Sophie, June 19th, across the top of his notebook. He is writing as she speaks. The war will begin in about 2 months. What war, he thought. Not the Balkan War, that had already begun. The war will be long, he wrote it down. Millions will die, for this war will be savage. He shook his head. Unimaginable destruction will take place. He was no longer looking at her. She was talking so fast that he only concentrated on her words, watching his pencil moving across the page. Thrones will be upset. Ancient states will be dissolved and new ones created. The end of the war will be followed by a long period of negotiations. Some new delusion then, but so matter of fact. The Triple Entente will be victorious in the end. Germany will be an empire no longer. The economic consequences of the war will be terrible for her. The Austrian Empire will be decomposed into its constituent elements. When she came out of her trance, he felt like the one who had been mesmerised. He could not get her words out of his head. The ramblings of an hysteric, spoken like an ancient sibyl. On the 28th of June, he read of the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand in Serbia. Greece had a treaty with Serbia to defend it if ever it were attacked by Bulgaria. Bulgaria mobilised. But the Greek Prime Minister, Eleftherios Venizelos, refused to take his country to war. As June turned into July, Antoniou told his friends about the case. They raised their eyebrows, asked questions, but he did not have any answers. The newspaper headlines spoke of escalating tensions. Then, on the 28th of July, Austria-Hungary declared war on Serbia, and the chain reaction ignited Europe. Greece would not enter the war until the 30th of June 1917, but Dr. Antoniou knew Sophie's prediction had been fulfilled. He sent an account of her prophecies to the Athens newspaper To Asti, and they were published from the 24th to the 27th of August 1914. The stuff which nightmares are made of. There were other private prophecies being made all across Europe. Henry Forman, who wrote a history of prophecy, among other things, heard from a Swiss friend of his, the theosophist Max Gysi, then living in Hampstead, about a Finnish physician, Dr. Edvard Wilhelm Liebeck. Liebeck, apparently for some years prior to 1914, had been having clairvoyant visions of, in his words, a great war which would change the map of Europe. Forman learnt that Liebeck had written to friends in London on the 7th of February 1914, saying, You will remember my speaking of the Great War 3 years ago? Yes, I believe still that there is very near the sudden breaking out of a European war with Germany, Sweden, Austria and Turkey attacking Russia at first, and consequently England and France being later drawn into the thing. I believe it is so near that when the summer comes, it sees the war in full flame. Gysi said that Liebeck's wife was also psychic, and had herself made predictions of a coming war in January 1914. She told several friends, writing to one of them, a Belgian artist, with instructions to lay up a store of food in anticipation. The Belgian artist replied that there was no cloud on the horizon, and rather that it tempted fate to make such pessimistic forecasts. A certain Mr. Lovett Fraser wrote to the Daily Mail in July, describing a vivid dream he had had of war in the air and a vision of destruction in Turkey, with airships dropping bombs on what was then still known as Constantinople. As he lay sleeping, Lovett Fraser saw a building which he took to be a factory with three tall chimneys standing on the Asiatic side of the Bosphorus. Airships approached and reduced it to ruins with their bombs. Lovett Fraser had never before visited the place or seen it with his waking eye. Member of Parliament George Lloyd, 1st Baron Lloyd, wrote the next day to confirm the existence of the place described. He was said to know the country well. As an officer in the Warwickshire Yeomanry, Lord Lloyd was called up in August and found himself sailing for Turkey. He landed with the Australian and New Zealand Army Corps, ANZACS, at Gallipoli. Under the title The Stuff Which Dreams Are Made Of, the Daily Mail called Lovett Fraser's dream an undoubted case of what has been called telesthesia, or perception at a distance, by some faculty which is not with man in his waking state. And in contrast to our own sceptical and materialistic times, the newspaper stated that the incident is not to be explained by the ordinary crude method of ascribing the vision to indigestion or an overdose of lobster, but rather by the existence of some curious power of passing beyond the limitations of space and time. It was a very public endorsement of premonition. The Maori Prophecy. One of the factors contributing to the First World War was the naval rivalry between Britain and Germany, and one of the consequences of that rivalry was the construction of HMS New Zealand, a ship believed to be under magical protection. The ship was paid for by New Zealand, then a dominion of the British Empire, in response to the German naval programme in 1909. Built in Glasgow, she was launched on the 1st of July 1911, and commissioned into service on the 19th of November 1912. She was an indefatigable class battlecruiser, packing 8 12-inch guns and 16 4-inch guns in an armoured body just short of 600 feet, 179.9 metres, with a top speed of 25 knots. New Zealanders living in London had commissioned a huge carving of the New Zealand coat of arms to be fixed on the after part of the superstructure, with another, smaller one attached to the front of the bridge. A silver bell was taken from the old HMS New Zealand, renamed Zealandia, and another New Zealand Londoner donated the ship's mascot, a bulldog called Pelorus Jack. A great deal of New Zealand pride went into her making. The new ship was intended to be the flagship of the China station based in New Zealand, but the growing threat of war changed all that, and she was deployed to the North Sea. However, in February 1913, she was dispatched on a world cruise, what Commander Cree called showing the flag to the rest of the empire. Captain Lionel Halsey set out for the other side of the world with his crew of 800. When she arrived in New Zealand, visiting 18 of her ports, almost half the country's population of 800,000 visited the ship. Some of those visitors were Maori chiefs. Invited on board by Lieutenant Jones, a number of chiefs of the Ngati Raukawa tribe, together with Major Bullinger and 250 cadets, visited the warship when she docked in Wellington. One of the chiefs, Rere Nikitini, gave an address with Keeper Oera interpreting, claiming a spectacular amount of credit for the ship. "This ship bears the name of our islands. It was presented on behalf of the people to His Majesty by our Prime Minister, Sir Joseph Ward. We, the Maori people, entirely concurred in the gift, and we realise that some part of its cost has come direct from the land of our ancestors. We are under the mana of England by special treaty, the Treaty of Waitangi. We are under the protection of England, therefore we give her a battleship. As to these garments, let them be as sails for your ship, carrying you to distant shores, and even to the presence of war, if that should happen. Let there be a further inspiration to you at that awful day, if the day comes, when our ship should clear for action. The natives then launched into their welcoming song, Toya Mete Waka. Captain Halsey thanked them for their gifts, the garments referred to in the speech. Described in the newspaper at the time as garments of war, these were a piu piu, a skirt made of black and white flax woven together, and what the paper called a pwa, a hei tiki, or magical amulet, a figure carved in jade, nephrite, and worn around the neck. Halsey was also made an honorary chief of the tribe. There is some debate on who the presenting chief actually was, with other sources giving the names of Te Hiu Hiu Tukino, paramount chief of the Ngati Tuwharetoa tribe, Manahimiona Te Ataotu, chief of the Ngai Tahu, and Mita Tau Popoki, chief of the Tuhurangi, Te Arawa, and Ngati Wahiao. Whoever the chief was, Commander Cree said that he also made a prophecy. One day, he announced, the ship would be in a great sea battle and would be hit three times, on the conning tower, on the after turret, and on the foretop, but casualties would be light. Another legend has it that the chief made three prophecies, that the ship would be involved in three battles, that the ship would be hit only once, and that no one on board would be killed. Cree was evidently telling the story second or third hand, since he had Green as the captain in 1913, when in fact he would only assume command in June 1915. However, there is sufficient documentary evidence to show that a gift of ritual items was made. The chief requested that Halsey wear the piu piu and hei tiki to protect his men in battle. Halsey took careful possession of the gifts and stowed them away for the appointed time, if it should ever come. He would keep the gifts, said the Evening Post, and preserve them in remembrance of the kindness of the Maoris. Time would tell whether the prophecies would come true. The Hand of Kitchener. As the deadline for Britain's ultimatum expired, the country was at war. Field Marshal Horatio Herbert Kitchener, 1st Earl Kitchener, the famous Kitchener of Khartoum, soon to become the even more famous face of British Army recruitment, may well have recalled the prediction of Cairo all those years ago. Cairo was the nom de plume of a certain individual calling himself Count Louis Hamon, which may or may not have been his real name. 20 years earlier, the palm reader or chiromancer, whence the name Cairo, visited him at the War Office in London, with the intention of making an impression of his hand. Cairo does not relate how he came upon this idea, but he seems to have had quite a collection of these impressions. Kitchener was then, in 1894, Sirdar of the Egyptian army at the time of the Mahdist War, and, according to Cairo, had returned to Britain to hand in his resignation over the Abbas affair, as Cairo called it, or frontier incident, as it was otherwise known. Abbas II was the insufferable teenage Khedive, or viceroy of Egypt, who disparaged Kitchener's Egyptian army, and especially its British officers, to Kitchener's face, and when Kitchener promptly resigned, begged him not to do so. The British government rebuked Abbas, and he publicly made amends. It was more likely that Kitchener was in London to receive the honour of being created Knight Commander of the Order of St. Michael and St. George. At any rate, a secretary brought him Cairo's card, and he had him sent in. "Well," said Kitchener, "so you want to have a look at my hand again?" "Again?" Cairo was taken aback. "Years ago," he said, "I went to see you like so many others, and I can only say you were most singularly accurate in everything you told me." At least that is what Kitchener said according to Cairo's account of their conversation. Elsewhere, Cairo recorded that their first meeting had been in 1887. Kitchener was a colonel at the time and relatively unknown. I had no idea you believed in such studies, said Cairo. I hardly dared come and ask you to let me have an impression of your hand. Look here, said Kitchener, turning round. He pointed to a 3-inch-high vase on his desk. Can you tell me anything about that? Cairo was again taken aback. He took the vase in his hands, looked it over, and put it down again. I am sorry, he said, but I don't know one vase from another. I never have had the inclination to study such things. Just so, laughed Kitchener. You have answered yourself. I have never studied hands, and you have. If a man makes a lifelong study of a thing, I expect him to know more about it than anyone else. So now you know why I went to see you many years ago. Cairo evidently had not told Kitchener everything, as now, leaning back in his chair, he asked him to explain the lines in his own clearly marked palms, as well as those of Gladstone, Stanley, and others. It turned out that Cairo had brought impressions of their hands with him. He took the 44-year-old's hand. Tell me what you like, said Kitchener, as long as the end is some distance off. I explained, said Cairo, the still higher positions and responsibilities that his path of destiny mapped out before him. Kitchener might have guessed or wished as much himself. However, that was not all. The heaviest and greatest of all, explained Cairo, would be undertaken in his 64th year, 1914. The date meant nothing at the time. How little either of us thought that in that year the most terrible war that England has ever engaged in would have broken out. Looking at Kitchener's hand, Cairo drew attention to a line that extended from his line of life, encircling the ball of the thumb, and crossed the line of fate and the line of success. This was the line of voyage. According to Cairo, this broke the lines of fate and success at the point where all my books on the subject show to be about the 66th year of age. Cairo was a numerologist as well as a palmist. He talked of a law of periodicity operating in human fate, determined by the calculation of Vedic numbers, the numbers of fate. The important moment for Kitchener was the opening of the Egyptian campaign in 1896. Cairo took each number from this year and added them together, 1 + 8 + 9 + 6, to get 24, adding the numbers again, 2 + 4, to get 6. So the Vedic number for 1896 was 6. In 1897, Kitchener was victorious at Atbarah and Omdurman, Vedic number 7. In 1898, Kitchener enjoyed rest from labour and was honoured by the nation, Vedic number 8. This sequence of Vedic numbers again occurred in the next century. 1914, Vedic number 6, saw the opening of the war. 1915, Vedic number 7, saw the creation of Kitchener's new army, not quite the same as victory in battle, but Cairo glossed over this, meaning that 1916, Vedic number 8, would again signal rest and honour. But this time Cairo saw this as meaning Kitchener's final rest, although he kept that to himself. Kitchener ran his pencil down the list of Cairo's figures. Stopping at 1916, he said, that then is perhaps the end. According to Cairo, he laughed. Strange, isn't it? But is there any indication of the kind of death it is likely to be? Yes, said Cairo, there are certainly indications, but not all perhaps the kind of end that one would be likely to imagine would happen to you. As well as being a palmist and numerologist, Cairo was also an astrologer. Now he proceeded to chart Kitchener's fate as it appeared in the stars. Having been born on June the 16th, 1850, he was in the first house of air, in the sign of Gemini, entering into the first house of water, the sign of Cancer, also house of the moon and detriment of Saturn. Taking these indications, together with the Kabbalistic interpretation of the numbers governing his life, the fatal year would be his 66th year, about June, and the death would be by water, probably caused by storm, air, or disaster at sea, water, with the attendant chance of some form of capture by an enemy and an exile from which he would never recover. Kitchener laughed. Thanks, I prefer the first proposition. But according to Cairo, he took him seriously. I must admit, said Kitchener, that what you tell me about danger at sea makes a serious impression on my mind, and I want you to note down among your queer theories, but do not say anything about it, unless if some day you hear of my being drowned, that I made myself a good swimmer, and I believe I am a fairly good one, for no other reason but that when I first visited you as quite an unknown man many years ago, you told me that water would be my greatest danger. You have now confirmed what you told me then, and have even given me the likely date of the danger. Cairo made an impression of Kitchener's hand using paper lying on the great man's desk. Finally, they said their goodbyes. I won't forget, said Kitchener, and as, of course, you believe in thought transference and that sort of thing, who knows if I won't send you some sign, if it should happen, that water claims me at the last. With international tensions mounting, Kitchener had been en route back to Cairo to resume his post. He got as far as a Channel steamer at Dover before being recalled. The armoured cruiser, HMS Black Prince, had already been dispatched to meet him. By late afternoon on the fateful day, he was at the Foreign Office in Whitehall. As the chimes of Big Ben marked the expiration of the British ultimatum to Germany at 11 p.m, midnight in Germany, Tuesday, the 4th of August, did Kitchener, the soon-to-be-appointed Secretary of State for War, look at his hand and perhaps think to himself, so it was foretold. Now it begins. From along the Mall in the direction of Buckingham Palace, a crowd could be heard singing God Save the King. Prime Minister Asquith and his ministers gathered in the cabinet room were interrupted by the First Lord of the Admiralty, Winston Churchill, bringing the news that he had sent the war telegram, commence hostilities against Germany, to the fleet. Lord Kitchener was among those present at an extraordinary council of war called by Asquith the next day. I wonder, wrote Churchill, who was also present, what the 20 politicians round the table would have felt if they had been told that the prosaic British cabinet was itself to be decimated in the war they had just declared. If we are to believe Cairo, Kitchener had already been told. The Sinking of the Amphion. On the evening of the 6th of August, 1914, 2 days after Britain had declared war on Germany, Miss Anne Jones, a pseudonym, was sitting in her room, waiting for some friends to call, when she was overcome by what she described as a feeling of great depression and fatigue. She lay down on the sofa and fell into a trance state, a kind of swoon, between sleeping and waking, as she called it. Her mind filled with the image of a sinking ship. When her friends arrived, they found her still in this exhausted condition, talking about a strange dream. That night, she wrote in her diary, had a bad dream of a ship sunk. The papers only carried news of a ship sunk on the morning of the 7th of August. After engaging and sinking the German mine layer, the Königin Louise, the light cruiser, HMS Amphion, had struck a mine on the morning of the 6th of August and gone down, taking with her over 100 of her crew. It was the first British loss of the war, and the first psychic experience. An account was sent in to the Society for Psychical Research and published in the December issue of The Journal. Psychical Researchers. All of these strange signs and portents did not go unnoticed. The popular press reported some of them, the Spiritualist press almost all of them. Nor did they go uninvestigated. At the outbreak of the First World War, there already existed an organisation for the investigation of what we would nowadays call the paranormal, the Society for Psychical Research, SPR. Founded in 1882 at the instigation of physicist Professor Sir William Fletcher Barrett and journalist Edmund Dawson Rogers, the Society was now in its 32nd year. Some of its best and perhaps most important work was already behind it. Seminal research into visions of apparitions had resulted in the book Phantasms of the Living in 1886, a landmark publication that was reported in the Times. By the time war was declared, many of the most important original members, Henry Sidgwick, died 1900, Frederick Myers, died 1901, Edmund Gurney, died 1888, and Frank Podmore, died 1910, were dead, but by no means forgotten. The acute sense of loss for these central personalities among the surviving and subsequent members made something like martyrs out of them, and a cult out of their martyrdom. The whole bizarre ensemble of the cross correspondences, short messages mediumistically received, was their holy book. The Society itself had survived that first generation. Not all of the initial wave of investigators had passed beyond the veil that shrouded their research interests, but more importantly, the Society's scientific approach had found favour among an intellectual, cultural, and aristocratic elite that ensured its continued existence. In 1914, there were 1,212 members of the SPR, and we find them engaged in their usual activities. They had voted in the German-born philosopher Dr. Ferdinand Canning Scott Schiller to take over from the French philosopher Henri Bergson as president, and had re-elected and co-opted familiar names to the council. Eleanor Sidgwick, widow of Henry Sidgwick, former principal of Newnham College, Cambridge, and former president of the Society, was honorary secretary. She shared the position with the Honourable Everard Fielding, second son of the late Rudolf Fielding, 8th Earl of Denbigh. One of Eleanor Sidgwick's brothers, the Right Honourable Gerald Balfour, later 2nd Earl Balfour, was also on the council and a vice president. Another of her brothers was the former Prime Minister, Arthur Balfour, 1st Earl Balfour, who was also a vice-president of the Society. For all the sirs, professors and doctors in the Society, it was the charisma of Mrs. Sidgwick that held them together. Almost everybody was devoted to her, especially the Society's office staff. She seemed to have an almost hypnotic effect on people. Winifred Coombe Tennant wrote in her diary after their first meeting in 1910 that, "I feel there was nothing she could ever ask of me that I would not do to my very utmost." Also on the council was the physicist Sir Oliver Lodge. He was another dominating figure, and much of the history of the Society during the war years revolves around his activities. Coombe Tennant described him as wonderfully tall and large, like a lion, although the SPR's research officer, Alice Johnson, thought him credulous. Other members of the council were equally important and well connected. They included John William Strutt, 3rd Baron Rayleigh, who had been awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics in 1904 for his part in discovering argon. He was also a former president of the Royal Society and member of the Privy Council, amongst many other awards and achievements too numerous to mention. The inventor, St. George William Lane Fox Pitt, was also a member. He was married to the daughter of the 9th Marquess of Queensbury, the one who gave his name to the Marquess of Queensbury rules in boxing, and famously called Oscar Wilde a sodomite, he meant sodomite, back in 1895. The Reverend Matthew Albert Bayfield, classical scholar, clergyman, and headmaster, acted in an unofficial role as the Society's padre. He officiated at the wedding of Helen Verrill, as we will hear, and William Salter, for example. The Right Reverend Bishop Boyd Carpenter was also a vice president. He had been president in 1912. Sir Lawrence Jones, 4th Baronet of Cranmer Hall, was on the council, as was the political scientist Goldsworthy Lowes Dickinson. His reaction to the war was to draw up plans for the League of Nations. The writer and politician Ernest Bennett, later Sir, he was knighted in 1930, was then a fellow of Pembroke College, with a dashing past and a still dashing future to come. The classical scholar Professor Gilbert Murray had been the basis for a character in one of Bernard Shaw's plays, Adolphus Cousins, in his 1905 work Major Barbara. He would become president of the SPR for 1915 and 1916. The philosopher L.P. Jacks, then a professor at Manchester College, Oxford, would serve as president in 1917 and 1918. The Polish medium, Stanisława Tomczyk, had been invited to the UK by the council, and a special committee was formed to investigate her claims, involving Everard Fielding, W.W. Bagoli, Eleanor Sidgwick, Helen Verrill, Dr. Woolley, and two of Fielding's friends, Mr. S. Cowper Coles, photographic expert, and Mark Barr, electrical expert. The medium was in poor health, and not all of the seances were successful, despite that the committee witnessed what appeared to be the levitation of a small ball. No fraud was detected. However, they decided that the results were inconclusive. Tomczyk had moved more than balls. She had also tugged heartstrings. She married one of the investigators, Fielding, in 1919. Sir William Barrett was involved in the investigation of a supposedly haunted house in Worcestershire. Eleanor Sidgwick was researching the medium Mrs. Piper's trance phenomena. The Society's research officer and editor, Alice Johnson, began the year by publishing A Reconstruction of Some Concordant Automatisms, which was as exciting as it sounded. The Society's young assistant research officer, Helen Verrill, was also working on the Icelandic seer case, that of so-called Dreaming Joe. There was no particular indication that members of the SPR were any better informed than the general public as to the coming crisis and terrible catastrophe of the Great War. And the question the SPR asked itself at the time was why, given the vast scale of the slaughter, were there not more cases of supposedly supernatural phenomena? The short answer is, there were, if only the Society had cared to look. It was only after the declaration of war, or even after the end of the war, that pieces of earlier puzzles began to be put together. The more involved members of the Society at that time were much concerned with the so-called cross correspondences, a series of cryptic psychic messages from different mediums that only made sense when considered as a whole and were taken as possible evidence of communication from deceased members of the SPR. Among these communications, there were several that appeared, in retrospect, to have predicted the war. But the analysis that revealed all this was only published in 1923. As for the more popular war prophecies that were being touted at the time, Dr. Schiller was dismissive. They were symptomatic of what he called a recrudescence of many primitive beliefs and practices brought on by war neurosis. Conan Doyle and Danger. Sir Arthur Conan Doyle was also a member of the Society for Psychical Research. He joined, or applied to join, the SPR in 1893 and had even investigated a haunted house with Dr. Sidney Scott and Frank Podmore in 1894. He also contributed his own prophecy, a short story, Danger, being the log of Captain John Sirius. Published in the Strand magazine in July 1914, it outlined the threat posed by unrestricted submarine warfare. A panel of naval experts had been invited to contribute their opinions, and most of them pooh-poohed the idea. But as Doyle later wrote, it turned out to be singularly prophetic. Conan Doyle had already written Great Britain and the Next War for the Fortnightly Review in 1913. He had been thinking about the possibility of war with Germany ever since his participation in the Prince Henry competition, an amateur motor car rally from Homburg in Germany to London via Edinburgh. Conan Doyle found the Germans warlike, recalling, "They were not only sure of the war, but of the date. It will be on the first pretext after the Kiel Canal is widened." Work on the canal was finished in June 1914. "It was this experience," said Conan Doyle, "which first made me take the threat of war seriously." Danger was not only prophetic in a metaphorical sense. According to Conan Doyle, "I have an occasional power of premonition, psychic rather than intellectual, which exercises itself beyond my control, and which, when it really comes, is never mistaken." So saying, "I saw as clearly as possible what the course of a naval war between England and Germany would be." The nub of the matter was that a small submarine fleet could starve Britain into submission by sinking ships trying to bring in food supplies. And as it happened, this is exactly what Germany tried to do. Sharing the Doyles' home at Windlesham was Lily Loder Simmons. She had been Jean's bridesmaid at her wedding to Conan Doyle in 1907. At some point, she had moved in with them as a companion to Jean and occasional nanny for the children. Her health had always been poor due to a chronic bronchial condition. Jean was looking after her just as much as she was looking after her children. It turned out that Lily had a gift for spirit communication using automatic writing. Lily was also deeply attached to Conan Doyle. Some say she was in love with him. Conan Doyle, for his part, seems to have been oblivious to this, although having a medium in the house was of great use to him. It also seems that Jean's conversion to spiritualism was at least partially due to Lily. Marching off to war. Some society members would fight in the war. Some would send their sons. All would be affected. Inevitably, some who sent their sons would not see them alive again, but such tragic loss would lead to some of the most convincing, and certainly still controversial, demonstrations of an afterlife. For the Conan Doyles, like many others, it was their last summer of innocence, a final dinner party in paradise before the fall. The Doyle household would be deeply affected by the war. Sir Arthur would initially preoccupy himself with his civilian volunteers. Lady Conan Doyle would run a home for Belgian refugees at nearby Gorsland. They would turn over a wing of their house to billet soldiers and have a large group of Canadian officers over for dinner once a week. Doyle's daughter from his first marriage, Mary, would work in the Vickers munitions factory. At the beginning of September, Kingsley, Doyle's son from his first marriage, enlisted as a private in the Royal Army Medical Corps. He had been studying in London to become a doctor and was now posted to Malta, the sick bay of the Mediterranean, as an ambulance driver. He had confessed to Mary that he could not reconcile the Hippocratic Oath with the ordinary job of a soldier. It was a secret he kept from his father, who only ever saw him as a soldier first, last, and all the time. As well as his eldest son, Doyle's brother, Innes, his two brothers-in-law, Malcolm Leckie and Leslie Oldham, and two nephews, Oscar Hornung and Alec Forbes, would serve in the war, as would his private secretary, Alfred Herbert Woody Wood. All of Lily Loder Simmons's five brothers were serving in His Majesty's Armed Forces, four with the British Army and one with the Royal Navy. The eldest, John Frederick, born 1873, was a major in the 1st Battalion, the South Staffordshire Regiment. Frederick Parland, born 1876, had joined the Navy in 1890 and became a Vice Admiral. Robert, Bob Francis, born 1884, was a captain in the 1st Battalion, the Cheshire Regiment. William Willie Crawshay, born 1886, was a captain with the 1st Battalion, the Wiltshire Regiment. The youngest, Thomas Lentil, born 1892, was a lieutenant in the 2nd Battalion, the Cameronians, the Scottish Rifles. The 1st Battalion, the Cameronians, left Glasgow for Southampton shortly after war was declared. They landed at Le Havre on the 15th of August. Conan Doyle tried to go to war, and did, in a manner of speaking, but more in the role of war correspondent than combatant. Other SPR members to put on uniform included Francis Deverell, Frank F.J. Aston, Major Michael Wogan Festing, and Lieutenant Colonel Henry Glanville Alan Moore. Another member, Frederick John Marion Stratton, was Assistant Director of the Solar Physics Observatory in 1914. He was also a provisional captain in the Territorial Army, and at the outbreak of war was commissioned a temporary captain in the Corps of Royal Engineers, the 8th of September 1914. He was promoted a temporary major and officer commanding signals of the 20th Divisional Signal Company, Royal Engineers, going to France in the summer of 1915. He survived the ordeal, showing his mettle by being mentioned in dispatches 5 times, awarded the DSO, 1917, made a Knight of the Légion d'Honneur of France, 1919, and appointed an Officer of the Order of the British Empire Military Division in 1929. He left the army with the rank of Lieutenant Colonel. He was a Fellow of Gonville and Caius College, Cambridge, a Fellow of the Royal Society, President of the Royal Astronomical Society, 1933 to 1935, and President of the SPR, 1953 to 1955. We will follow the adventures of some of those sons who went to war. Others we will only have time to mention in passing. Geoffrey, the younger son of the Reverend Bayfield, was already serving in the Royal Navy when war was declared. Robert and Lewis Palmer, sons of Lord Selborne, were both in the Hampshire Regiment. Robert, Bobby, had joined in 1913. Oliver Littleton, son of Lord Alfred and Dame Edith Littleton, joined up in August 1914, serving first with the Bedfordshire Regiment before being gazetted to the Grenadier Guards. Raymond Lodge, son of Sir Oliver Lodge, joined the South Lancashire Regiment in September 1915. Christopher Crough Coombe Tennant, son of Charles and Winifred Coombe Tennant, took a commission in the Welsh Guards in May 1917. Others were more difficult to trace, but nonetheless important to mention. L.P. Jacks saw his 3 sons off to war. Charles Richer had 5 sons in uniform. These young men, much loved and from good families, were, in a sense, also angels in the trenches. The Upstairs Committee. On the 30th of June 1914, readers of the Times may have been somewhat astonished by the revelations of Dr. F.C.S. Schiller. He had given his address as the new president of the SPR to an audience at the Royal Society for Medicine on Wimpole Street the evening before. Schiller began by acknowledging the services to psychical research of his philosophic predecessors, Henry Sidgwick, William James, and Henri Bergson, all names still known to posterity. With the Society's pedigree established, he sought to establish his own authority by challenging the work that had been done. Beyond some logical and metaphysical niceties, it was the evidence that was found to be lacking, not in quantity but in quality. Schiller argued that the evidence so far collected by the Society was, he said, merely historical and hardly at all experimental, and that this meant that the evidence must continually diminish in cogency owing to mere lapse of time. He had to acknowledge that many sciences, like astronomy and paleontology, had to rely on historical evidence, so the approach in itself was not unscientific. The mysterious occurrences which the Society for Psychical Research had for the first time in human history essayed to investigate systematically had never been brought under control, and for this reason had never been able to make good their claim to truth. Unless, therefore, their alleged knowledge could stand the pragmatic test by becoming applicable to human affairs, psychical researchers could not hope to convince the world, nor perhaps even themselves, that it was genuine knowledge. Schiller had proven himself to be something of a skeptic, and the Times reader would most probably have been nodding happily up until this point. Then, under the subheading, A Society on the Other Side, success in psychical research, moreover, required not merely systematic and continuous efforts and much larger resources, both in men and money, than had yet been placed at the Society's disposal, but also intelligent cooperation in what, for purposes of reference, might be called the spirit world. Psychical research was far from popular on Earth, where everyone had a direct interest in knowing about his future life, if any. There was reason to suppose that in the beyond it must be far more unpopular, because it might well seem unnecessary and degrading to recur to the dreadful past. However, the investigators of the complicated evidence of cross-correspondences seemed to be arriving at a conviction that something like a Society for Psychical Research was beginning to operate from the other side, as more scientifically minded researchers joined the majority. There was, on the side of the living, the SPR group of automatists, the select few who could communicate with the upstairs committee. They were Margaret Verrill, wife of Arthur Verrill, and their daughter Helen Verrill, Mrs. Holland, Alice Kipling, 1868 to 1948, the sister of Rudyard Kipling and married to John M. Fleming, 1858 to 1942, a colonel in the British Army, and the Max, two brothers and three sisters of the McKinnon family, Mrs. Willett, Winifred Coombe Tennant, 1874 to 1956, she was to play a central and surprising role in the secret life of the society, and Mrs. King, Dame Edith Littleton, widow of the politician Alfred Littleton. From the other side came messages from the communicators, particularly a group of seven. The three principal founders of the SPR, Henry Sidgwick, died 1900, Frederick Myers, died 1901, and Edmund Gurney, died 1888, Francis Maitland Balfour, died 1882, Mary Catherine Littleton, died 1875, Annie Eliza Marshall, known as Phyllis, died 1876, and Laura Littleton, née Tennant, but not related to the Coombe Tennants, died 1886. Eyebrows must have been raised by the article in the Times, but it ended with a fanfare for science rather than spiritualism. There was no reason why the methods of science here too should not vanquish difficulties which did not differ in kind from those of all knowing. In consequence of Schiller's advocacy of the experimental, the SPR, through its appointed officers and members, would spend most of its time during the war years hunting for what it thought could be experimental evidence, and largely ignored a great deal of merely historical evidence, the first-hand accounts of those experiencing these things that the war produced. I confess that it led me to a kind of exasperation to read continually of SPR members shutting themselves up in darkened séance rooms trying to contact the spirit world, or tabulating the endless cross-correspondences when the war was raging outside, a war that uniquely produced such a rich flow of paranormal experience. The defect in Schiller's analysis was that he overlooked the fact that perhaps psychical research was properly more like paleontology than physics. As a consequence of its academic founders and its academic presidents, the SPR had an academic reputation. Whilst this brought a measure of acceptability, interestingly, the SPR was more acceptable 100 years ago than it is today, it also produced a rarefied and rather dry atmosphere. A certain H.A. Dallas wrote to Light to complain that the SPR's regular periodical at the time usually contains matter only attractive to experts, or at least to those who have specialised in certain rather difficult phases of this research, in contrast to the French Annales Physiques, which was apparently much more interesting. In those days, the offices of the Society for Psychical Research were at 20 Hanover Square in London. The square was then little changed from its elegant 18th century design. In contrast to the male-dominated council, the offices of the SPR were run entirely by women, and here 54-year-old Alice Johnson ruled the roost. A graduate of Newnham College with a first class in natural science, she was seen by some as a rather austere little figure with an academic manner that alarmed them, or even having a love of power, in the words of Isabel Newton, the society's secretary. Winifred Coombe Tennant found her kind, even splendid, but rather new womanish. Newton conceded that her rule was absolute, but described her day-to-day manner as gentle and rather shy, although she never failed to be exacting to a degree in the matter of accuracy and thoroughness. It was a paradoxical portrait. She was devoted to the SPR. It too could have been described as an austere little society with an academic manner, and Newton observed that she sacrificed much for it. The Johnsons were a large family, well known in Cambridge, and after graduation, Alice had held the post of first demonstrator in animal morphology at the Balfour Laboratory. She knew the Sidgwicks, of course. Mrs. Sidgwick had been instrumental in setting up the laboratory, and Johnson went on to become her private secretary when Sidgwick was appointed principal of Newnham College. She had early shared the Sidgwicks' interest in psychical research, taking part in seances with Mrs. Piper and assisting Eleanor Sidgwick in the Brighton Experiments in Thought Transference. She had also worked with them on the Census of Hallucinations, published in 1894. It seemed natural that she should take up more official functions for the Society. In 1899, she was appointed editor of the Society's Proceedings. In 1903, she became organising secretary. In 1908, she was appointed research officer. She was credited as being a factor in holding the Society together after the deaths of Henry Sidgwick in 1900 and Frederick Myers in 1901, and worked with Richard Hodgson in completing Myers's unfinished book, Human Personality. One of the SPR's neighbours at 20 Hanover Square was W.B. Yeats's Irish Literary Society. Yeats would sometimes pop in to the SPR's rooms. After talking to Johnson about psychical matters on one occasion, he remarked, in reference to her sceptical attitude, "It is my belief that if you people had been standing round when the Almighty was creating the world, he couldn't have done it." Johnson was first aided by Isabel Newton, who joined in 1903 as Johnson's assistant. When Johnson became research officer, Newton took her place as secretary, serving in that role for the next 30 years. Unlike most of the rest of the society, she had no Cambridge connection and no further education, and she had had no previous interest in psychical research before applying for the position as advertised, but on her retirement was made an honorary member, a rare accolade, and remembered for a practical knowledge of psychical research that few of her contemporaries could rival. But more than that, she gained the confidence and affection of all the members with whom she came into contact. Willie Salter noted that where Alice Johnson was small in build, austere in appearance and reserved in manner, Newton was, in all respects, the opposite. She had such beautiful eyes, hair and skin, and good features too, said Neil Walker, secretary to Sir Oliver Lodge in later years. Yet, like Johnson, she too was devoted to the society. Like Johnson, she remained unmarried throughout her life. And, like Johnson, her devotion to the society was perhaps more particularly a devotion to Mrs. Sidgwick. Salter did not think her witty, but noted a keen sense of humour, often observed in connection with the many oddities of mind and temperament with which her daily duties made her familiar. Salter and others who knew her well were also treated to her gift for mimicry, amusing them with her ability to impersonate mutual friends and acquaintances to the life and throw their foibles into sharp relief, but always with such warm good humour, as Lydia Allison, secretary of the American SPR, put it. The artist and psychologist Ina Jeffson found that she was always good company. It was Newton who formulated the general principle of psychical research. If ever you have a brilliant new idea, you are almost certain to find out that it has already been said much better by Mrs. Sidgwick. Johnson could have said the same thing, perhaps did. Both were Sidgwickians through and through. Shirley Thatcher, probably then in her early to mid-twenties, would join them in the role of assistant secretary, and when war came, her husband would be called up. Even in elegant Hanover Square, they could not escape the shadow of the war. In 1915, Johnson would add in a letter to her on society business, "I hope that you are getting good news of Mr. Thatcher." This was probably George Robin Thatcher. According to his medal card, he had been a chief petty officer, a senior non-commissioned officer, in the Royal Naval Air Service, before being promoted to lieutenant in the Royal Garrison Artillery. Daughter of the Regiment. Johnson's assistant research officer was Helen Woolgard de Gaudrian Verrill, 1883 to 1959. Helen was the daughter of the noted Cambridge classicists Arthur and Margaret Verrill, both of whom were also high-profile members of the SPR, leading the philosopher C.D. Broad to call her a true daughter of the regiment being the Society for Psychical Research, of course. It was no exaggeration. She had grown up surrounded by the great names of the SPR. She had fond memories of childhood games with Frederick Myers and was familiar enough with Richard Hodgson to call him Hodgepodge, although she never knew Edmund Gurney and recalled Henry Sidgwick as a remote Olympian figure. It was different with Eleanor Sidgwick. Her mother educated her at home, with Elfrida Tillyard, later to become a poet, mystic, and briefly a disciple of Aleister Crowley, before she entered Newnham College, little more than a stone's throw away. She knew Rupert Brooke, even co-authoring a play with him and the baritone Clive Carey, From the Jaws of the Octopus, or Cardi, which they performed at the Hotel Silvretta in Klosters, Switzerland, on the 29th of December, 1908. For his part, Brooke was a great admirer of her father, A.W. Verrill. She was there with a group of Cambridge friends to enjoy the skiing, including Marjorie and Noel Olivier, daughters of Sidney Olivier, first Baron Olivier. Noel was the object of Brooke's amorous attentions. Trinity scholar Jerry Pinsent, Dorothy Osmaston, later Lady Leighton, Dolly Rose, Hugh Morgan, Bill Hubbock, and his fiancée Eva Spielman, most of them members of an informal group of happy campers dubbed the Neo-Pagans by Virginia Woolf. Even before she joined the SPR in 1905, her mother had involved her in psychical experiments, telepathy, table turning, and automatic writing, producing some of the famed cross correspondences. She started working for the Society in 1908, and in 1910 was appointed assistant research officer. In 1916, she would become research officer and editor of the Journal, and from 1921, of the Proceedings as well. In 1922, she joined the Council, and in 1953 was elected a vice president. In life outside the Society, she would hold a number of important public appointments. Broad remembered her for her intellectual integrity, and G.W. Lambert commended her sound reasoning and good judgment. Her friend Elfrida called her the virtuous Helen, meaning to be unkind. When Winifred Coombe Tennant met her in 1910, she described her as very charming, with blue eyes that are frank and sympathetic, the head cast upon noble lines, the figure tall and very feminine. However, as she got to know her better, Winifred found her all intellect and no heart, all rather arid science and no imagination, and ultimately, baffling, chilling, and discouraging. Helen had recently been given the use of a new room. Working in the library had proven unsuitable due to the continual interruptions. Here, she would decide the fate of the angels in that biggest paranormal mystery of the war years, Mons. The plan. The upstairs committee had what came to be known as the plan, centering on Mrs. Willett. Beyond providing proof of the survival of the personality after death, something they had been doing since 1901, the committee also wanted to save the world, and as the world raced towards Armageddon, it certainly needed saving. The identity of Mrs. Willett, as Winifred Coombe Tennant was known in connection with her mediumistic communications, was a closely guarded secret, known only to a few members of the SPR Council, principally Sir Oliver Lodge, Eleanor Sidgwick, Gerald and Arthur Balfour, and others such as Margaret Verrill and Alice Johnson. Winifred had married into the SPR. Evelyn, or Evie, the sister of her husband Charles, was married to Frederick Myers, and she got to know him well in the 1890s. She was greatly moved when Myers died in 1901 and joined the society herself. However, the key to Winifred's deeper involvement was the loss of her 18-month-old daughter, Daphne, in 1908. Grief-stricken and seeking answers, she had started automatic writing, possibly at the instigation of Margaret Verrill. She was apparently successful in this, but the upstairs committee were soon trying experiments with her to achieve more direct communication, which became known as daylight impressions, DIs, to make you hear without writing in the supposed words of Myers. Apparently communicating through Leonora Piper on the 23rd of October 1910, the deceased Edmund Gurney made a series of amazing statements that were incomprehensible and marvellous, as Winifred recorded in her diary. Gurney, it turned out, was in love with her and wanted her to have his child, hence the incomprehensible. But even more than that, the result will be an optimus opus. Gurney said that Myers concurred, and Sidgwick would also soon send his agreement. She was at the Lodge's home at Marymount in Birmingham and talked over the matter with Sir Oliver. Birmingham, she found, very large and hideous, but Marymount was filled with books and beautiful things. She was introduced to Mrs. Piper as Mrs. Archer to disguise both her real name and SPR identity. Winifred had seen Mrs. Piper before on the 8th of May 1910 when she was in a trance state in the SPR's rooms at 20 Hanover Square, but had not been introduced to her. Then she had thought the thing like a live vivisection. It was quite different in the congenial setting of the Lodge's home. Winifred had had no intention of having another child. She had already had three, Christopher, Alexander and Daphne, and confessed that there had been no opportunity of any sort of conception. Myers, communicating through Winifred on the 17th of November 1910, stressed the importance of the undertaking. Gurney's child that is to come will be a great incarnation of divine effulgence, ending the communication with, "Know that this is your destiny." Before the year was out, the way became clear. Gerald Balfour expressed a wish to meet her, and Winifred was invited to Fisher's Hill, the family home of the Balfours. She arrived on the 4th of February 1911. She thought Betty, Lady Balfour, very charming, clever, natural, etc., but Gerald was intensely attractive. Mrs. Sidgwick, Sir Oliver and Arthur Balfour joined them. J.G. Piddington was already there as a live-in cross-correspondences expert, but it was Gerald who made the greatest impression. "I am deeply impressed by Gerald Balfour," she wrote. There would be more meetings with Gerald, more being deeply impressed by him. Communications from Gurney pushed her towards him. She was falling in love with him. Fell in love with him, and he with her, and from her point of view, his wife, Betty, seemed to acquiesce. Winifred's husband, Charles, always such a distant figure in her diaries, unless she was complaining about him, seemed totally unaware of her growing infidelity. To begin with, it was the holiest love, but it eventually became physical as well. The result was Augustus Henry Sericold, born the 9th of April 1913. Henry was named after Henry Sidgwick, and it was as Henry that he was generally known to the world, at least until he changed his name. Privately, to Winifred, he was the babe, and by the beginning of 1914, the wise one. As the country went to war, the SPR was nursing in its bosom the next world saviour. For her part, Winifred launched herself on a public career. Soon after the war began, she was appointed to the Mayor's Committee for Distress, the Prince of Wales's Fund, and the Soldiers and Sailors Families Association Committee. The Prince of Wales's Fund was the largest of the many private subscription funds that appeared at this time to support the war effort, and particularly the needs of families bereft of their breadwinner. At the time, Winifred was awaiting an operation for either a kidney stone or appendicitis, and experiencing intermittently fearful pain, as she put it. Her trepidation before the operation mixed with her desperation at the war. She had seen the Kaiser in 1911 during his visit to Britain, and remarked then that he was the menace to the peace of Europe, and on the 4th of August 1914 wrote of the awful madness of our joining in this war, slaughtering our brothers for no purpose. As she lay recovering from the operation, she read the casualty lists printed in the papers, and was horrified to see Gerald Balfour's nephew Oswald reported wounded on the 19th of September. Oswald was the son of Lady Frances and Colonel Eustace James Anthony Balfour. Some days later, she was relieved to learn that he had only been slightly wounded. Others of her acquaintance were not so fortunate. One Captain Mark Haggard of the Welsh Guards and nephew of the writer H. Ryder Haggard, only recently married to Betty Vaughan, died of wounds received, possibly in the same action as Oswald. His dying cry had been, "Stick it, the Welsh!" According to Sir Oliver Lodge, it would never be forgotten in the Principality. Soon afterwards, Betty left to become an ambulance driver in France. Signs of war were not just in the newspapers. She reported seeing armed soldiers guarding bridges and tunnels, stations full of men in uniform, her carriage crammed with them too, the sounds of bugles and firing in the distance, and recruits drilling on the golf links. In October, a family of Belgian refugees arrived to take up residence in the gardener's cottage, just a few of the more than 250,000 fleeing the Kaiser's armies who would arrive in Britain. "How it brought war home to me," she wrote, looking into their strained faces. Psychical rivals. The SPR did not have the psychical field to itself. For some years, an international club for psychical research had met to discuss things paranormal. A note in the Times for the 30th of May 1914 records that they met in Regent Street, with Lady Churchill presiding and Lady Muir Mackenzie, Miss Lynd Af Haggerby, Major General Sir Alfred Turner, the Reverend Sir C.J.M. Shaw, and Miss Estelle Stead in attendance. Mrs. Annie Besant was giving a talk on common sense in psychical research. There was, she said, nothing really more dangerous in all research into the hidden movements of nature than to suppose miracles where there was nothing but the natural law. It was sensible enough advice, but quite unthinkable that the Times of today would report such a talk, reminding us that things were indeed different. The Times article said that they were celebrating their third anniversary, meaning that they were formed in 1911. However, a disclaimer had been printed in the Journal of the SPR as early as 1909, distancing itself from the ICPR. In consequence of statements that have lately appeared in several newspapers about a club to be called the International Club for Psychical Research, a number of inquiries have reached us. We therefore desire to make it clear that, Contrary to the suggestion conveyed by some of the newspaper paragraphs, the proposed club has no connection of any kind with our society. It has also been stated that Professor Barrett will be the first president of the club, but Professor Barrett informs us that this statement is entirely groundless. Although the Times article was not more specific than locating the club in Regent Street, following the half-erased footprints of the past, we are led to the Alchemical Society. In an issue of Light, one reads that the Alchemical Society held its meetings at the International Club for Psychical Research, and elsewhere that the Alchemical Society held its meetings in Villivent de Curler's occult library, also home to his occult club in Piccadilly Place, a shabby side street sandwiched in between Regent Street and Piccadilly. It was here, in this nest of bizarre clubs and societies, that Dr. Elizabeth Severn, castigated as an evil genius by Freud, turned up to lecture on some mystical aspects of alchemy in May 1914 at a meeting chaired by the noted Scottish chemist John Ferguson, Regius Professor of Chemistry at Glasgow University and a Fellow of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, as well as the owner of one of the most extensive collections of alchemical texts outside the British Library. Dr. Curler was arrested for fortune-telling in April 1915, and by some unfortunate mistake, his lawyer submitted a plea of guilty. He was sentenced to 6 weeks' imprisonment and subsequent deportation. An appeal was granted, and his friends rallied round to see what could be done. His friends thought that a key factor was the question of de Curler's nationality. It seems to have been assumed that he was German, but he had been born in Switzerland to a Russian father and a French mother. Thunder, oblivion, and brother ghosts. Smoke, smoke everywhere. Tramping men, high hope, a young face, thunder, oblivion. On the 17th of July 1914, the poet William Butler Yeats sat in a darkened room as a medium related a communication from the spirit world. Its meaning would soon become clear, and Yeats would later tell this story to the Ghost Club. Yeats's involvement in the club is known, although largely only among scholars of Yeats. His actual activities there have been almost entirely overlooked. The Ghost Club was a private but not quite secret dining club that met in London to discuss ghosts, naturally. Sir William Crookes, one of the leading lights of the SPR, was president of the Ghost Club throughout the duration of the war. The Ghost Club would also be affected by the war, and some members affected most deeply. They too would send their sons and spend the war years on tenterhooks, waiting on every post for news from the front. In 1914, the Ghost Club had 22 members, and, like Crookes, many of them were also members of the SPR. Usually 8 or 9 turned up for meetings. All of them were interesting, but few are remembered now, save for W.B. Yeats. The Ghost Club met once a month on Wednesday evenings at the Maison Jules on Jermyn Street. It was a smart and relatively new establishment with an enviable pedigree. Lieutenant Colonel Nathaniel Newnham Davis mentioned the restaurant in his Gourmet's Guide to London. The Jules in question had been manager at the Barclay, one of the best places to dine in London, and then the Savoy, before setting up on his own. Jermyn Street had formerly been known for its private hotels, shops and bachelors' rooms, but before the war had been colonised by half a dozen or so restaurants. Jules had taken 2 houses on the street to offer hotel accommodation and dining. An illuminated globe hung outside the door. Going inside, one entered an anteroom, formed by a glazed glass screen first, leading into a long room that ran the length of the building. It was painted all white, while gilt capitals decorated white pillars and marble. A clock and candelabra of blue china sat on the mantelpiece above the fire. The room ended in a large window, almost a wall of glass, according to Newnham Davis. There was a second room to the back that could be partitioned off, and it was probably here that the ghost club found the privacy they required. Jules himself, grown rather fuller of figure and whiter of hair, would have met the members as they...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.